Welcome back to WordCamp San Diego. We're all glad you made it back today. Special thanks to our gold sponsors, WooCommerce, Jetpack, Bluehost, Zilog, Pantheon, and Host Duplex. T-shirts exchange, if you want a different size, you can do that in the lobby. There's plenty of t-shirts over there. After this talk, there should be Chipotle burritos in the courtyard. So, you're on the way, delivery, so you're by the time this is over. So save some room for that. Closing remarks will be in this room where the sponsors will have giveaways. So stay till the end if you want some sweet swag. There's some flat screens and HomePod or whatever that new Apple thing is. have a great work camp. I'm pleased to introduce Mr. Dre Armeda. He's been really instrumental in getting work camp started here in Southern California. He's been, you know, an inspiration to myself and also a great businessman. He's a veteran, and we're really excited to have him for this year's work camp. So give him a warm round of applause. So, I'll be talking to you after this for some type of paid agreement to get some training. I pay for value, especially when you're not before us. So really, why are we here? Is it because I wear a lot of hats? Because I get obnoxiously loud, especially around lunchtime with his fake burritos? Is it because we're in San Diego and I love tacos?
Yeah. Yeah.
Maybe. Maybe it's because this is a military-themed work camp, and I certainly appreciate that. I am a veteran. I'm a 12-year U.S. Navy veteran. After that career. I then transitioned after
No, I was scared. I was scared to change, but I knew I had to do something, right? The outcomes were likely jail or work. So it's a bad situation to be in. But I made that decision. I did enlist in the United States Navy. And change is hard, right? It can be really intimidating. It's not hard to find situations in life where I think leave us feeling helpless, out of control, right? I think it happens more often than anything. And sometimes, so much so that we do nothing, right? You sit back, you settle knowing that we probably deserve more. That's pretty tragic, right? We end up living with this state of indecision. Indecision. Indecision is a byproduct of fear. And I think we all fear something, right? We all, in this room, have feared something. We've been afraid of something, right? And I think that the difference between those that are successful and not is what they do with those fears. Right? We need to accept those things and figure out. Fear is natural when it comes to change. Can anybody guess why? We fear what we don't know. Like the big dude coming in the back of the room right there with the mask and the machete, what the hell is he doing? I don't know, I'm pretty damn fearful right now, right?
That's good.
No, your brain fears what it doesn't know, right? Because what it does know makes it feel safer. And I think that's whether you like it or not, that's the reality that we live in. The reality of humans is that we live in routines. When you're familiar with something, you know what to expect. You're familiar with that routine, right? That becomes comfortable in a way. And I think it gives us a good sense of stability. Have you guys ever played the what-if game? No? Mm-hmm. What if I make this transition to this job? It's not what I want, or it doesn't lead me to the successes that I want. What if I don't get all these clients that I need to be successful on my own as a new agency or development design shop? That what-if game. And you start to focus on, what if my fears really do come true? And I think your fear can easily put you in a place that you just don't move. You become complacent. We also fear failure. What if I oopsie? What if the grass isn't greener on the other side? I was pretty fearful coming into this room today. I wasn't sure what to expect. What if I lose it? What if I completely tank this discussion and none of you get any value from what I'm talking about? You know, I hadn't spoken publicly in quite some time, and my confidence was pretty low coming into today. What happens if no one learns something from this, right? I doubted myself completely, 100%. And that's scary. That's another problem that we deal with when it comes to change, is self-doubt. We all doubt ourselves at a certain point. Even the most confident person, Chris Lima, in this room, has had experiences with self-doubt. Right? Self-doubt is super complicated. Who's ever sat contemplating a huge life change, wondering if you can really do it successfully? You start to look outward and really compare yourself to others doing what it is you want to do. Right? I think we've all done that in some capacity. You ever seen go, wow, that looks really hard. That's taking on too much. You know, you start to break down that huge life change and consider, well, should I even Step out of your comfort zone. And stop being comparative. Look at others for inspiration, but don't get frustrated when you don't get there instantly. It takes a lot of work, elbow grease, effort, a little bit of luck. It's not going to happen on day one. Be realistic and around your expectations. You still need to work and stay focused. Even a black belt today was a white belt when we started, right? An expert in this room was once a beginner. Measure yourself against yourself to see how far you've gone. Project people, phase your goals, right? Make sure that things are in consumable chunks. Planning is more than half the battle. Another symptom of self-doubt is the tendency to wait for validation. We look at others to validate, before we jump off that typing board. Example, so I created this thing, right? And I think this thing is super cool, but I need your opinion. What do you think about that? I think this is super awesome. Holy shit, you validated me. Now I think it's super awesome. What about the other side of that? So I created this thing. You shake your head as if you consumed some super-sized box of failure, and you let me know. I feel super disappointed, and now failure. I came to you to validate. I think we got to be careful with that. I think it starts with validating ourselves and our ideas. You have to build a vision, a measurable commitment to success. And I think you leverage those plans as you create things. And then through the iteration, right, you lean back to that plan. Haters are going to hate. And we all know that. How many of y'all deal with haters on a daily basis? Don't hate me. You feel the hate, go back, and you reference that vision. You reference that measurable commitment and continue to push forward. Validate yourself. Don't let others dictate your value. I think if you believe in yourself, others are going to follow. It really comes down to you forging forward instead of allowing people to dictate your pace. Be the person you want to be. I think, again, it all starts with stepping out of that box. A journey of 1,000 miles begins with a single step. After 12 years in the Navy, I decided to move on, and there was various factors that kind of led to this, a personal and external factors. I felt I had all the tools in place to be successful. In fact, I had a lot of technical training and practical application of those training in high-stress environments, performance-demanding situations where people could die. Real people. But when I decided that this was kind of the direction for me, I was laughed at by my shipmates. My chief chewed my ass and said, "Hey, I'm sorry, you got 12 years in, you're up for chief, you're eligible, and you're looking to make it pretty quick. What the hell are you thinking? 12-year-old. I was convinced, though, and I thought I was making the right decision. So I was doing side work on the side of this organization. I was kind of prepping to transition out and to separate. And everything worked out. I thought, I felt that at 29 I was more marketable than I would be at retirement, which reached 40, things changed a little bit, right, the market. So I didn't listen to them. I moved on. I moved on after 12 years. And I began my journey of 1,000 miles, right, with that first single step. And it was crazy. This was October of 2007, and we moved to the northwest suburbs of Chicago, where I went to work locally at this organization that I had been working with prior to separation, Moonlighting. And everything worked out as I planned. Until it didn't. In December of 2007, that company was acquired by an offshore company. We didn't get to keep our jobs, right? So I was there 2 months removed from a fairly stable but not glamorous military career. In a place where I knew nobody, and literally the middle of nowhere, by cornfields. And no job. Good times. So not to depress you, but certainly I was scared, right? It was funny. I was that guy in every single seat at an Oprah episode, and I remember she was just handing out self-doubt. It was crazy. There was a lot of self-doubt that came from that, right? And I think in situations like that, when you make decisions, sometimes they don't work out to your advantage, and it will cause you and cast out, right? How the hell am I going to survive this? Maybe I wasn't as prepared as I thought I was, right? Well, little did I know that was the beginning. Now, sometimes I think when you're going through challenging times, you tend to feel isolated, like, geez, I'm the only person in the world going through these changes, making these decisions, and that's tough, man. It's tough to deal with from a business perspective. Think of your own personal topics. It's something we deal with. We feel you need outside reassurance to do a thing, right? And it's almost like you need everybody's opinion to validate what you're doing. You don't want to make your own decisions. And I've made some pretty big decisions. Leaving the Navy is one of them. And in other instances, I felt super paralyzed. Like, how do I do? I need this outside validation. And I can tell you from personal experience that the hardest part of that, of making a huge decision, an impactful decision, is when you're agonizing over it. Right? I know I heard that little dude in my head going, you should take the plunge, you should do it. Or in other cases, he turns around and says, hey, maybe you should take a more sensible approach to this, right? And work with what you have. By the way, that makes everyone around you go absolutely apeshit crazy. It's a terrible place to be, and everybody around you is going to feel that. It can be, painfully disruptive. I think for yourself, again, those around you, your business, your future, your aspirations. But again, indecision. Indecision is death. Paralysis through analysis is failure. It's real talk, man. I think that the worst decision you can make is no decision at all. No, it's funny. Like, when you get to that stage, that there's such a weight lifted when you're making decisions, right? You're accepting those changes. You're implementing controls. You're living outside of your box. It's liberating. So be decisive and expeditious. You have to make those decisions. But I get it. Sometimes you kind of channel your inner empathy, right? You only get one shot. And I missed a chance to blow. This opportunity comes. You try to make a big decision, right? And you think, well, you only have one chance, but you end up in that current state forever. Example, you stay in a job that you hate, or you can quit and be an employee. Right? Don't paint yourself into a corner motivated by fear or uncertainty, and it feels sometimes like that's your only choice, right? You don't feel like you have to stay in a situation. I mean, there's no other option, because the truth is, there's always an option. Sometimes you can take a little brainstorming again to elbow grease to come up with a possible solution, but there's always choices. Make a choice to drink too much caffeine. I think another problem people face when contemplating change is that they limit themselves to focus on external things. I don't have a seat. We're talking about change. We focus on external things to define our identity and our worth, right? What job do I have? What possessions do I own? How much money do I make? And we put a really strong emotional weight on this, right? It's human nature, I think. Chris, I like my cool car. Like, that's the coolest car. If I don't have it, I'm gonna pay for it. No, we also fear that, that we can lose these things, right? We lose these possessions that we have earned and that we're connected to. People often ask, what do you do, right? What's your response? We're completely connected to our job. That is something that we drive, right? It's part of our identity, a huge part. I think a much more important thing is to focus on the value of relationships. How you help others. I think that can be a really wonderful symbiotic relationship. There's a lot about it. I think when you help someone and they appreciate what you do, or just the notion of being able to help someone, you feel good about yourself. I think it's a more genuine feeling of contentment. I most certainly think it provides a better sense of self-worth. Although I do like my Jeep upgrades. focus on helping people. I think along with focusing on the external world comes the fact that you cling to certain possessions and statuses, perks, that you've been given along the way to save being an enemy. You start to fear losing those things as well as you start thinking about transitioning. You handcuff yourself to a job that you hate. I'll stay until I use all my vacation days or like when I'm eligible for pension. Shit, I left the Navy at 12 years. I was 8 years removed from being a pilot. I made the change. Those are crutches. Now you get into that, I'll stay until mentality.
Okay.
Is that the healthiest for you? Nope. And those around you? You know, seriously, there's a lot of people that won't do the job, really, because of the, you know, the promises of that that pension and that holiday, the 3 weeks of vacation. You think when you're 80 years old, you're going to be happy that you wasted your life in 3 weeks of vacation? Probably not. So I think you turn it around, and if something like that, vacation as an example, is something that's important to you, when you go look for that next interview, that you make that a requirement. You go to business on your own. Awesome. Vacation is part of what will lead to my success. It has to be a requirement, and you set that as an expectation. You need to keep moving things forward and not feel guilty or get caught in those mental safety nets, right? Because it happens along the way. And those, you know, geez, might not resonate to you, but find those crutches that you're dealing with, right? When my mom told me to ship or get off the boat, I did. In 2011, the week before the first WordCamp San Diego,
woohoo!
I went as full-time employee number one at Sweet. So I'm really proud of that. And my crutch was my way of living at the time. I was working for Semper Energy, SoCal Gas, San Diego Gas and Electric, in their APOSET group there. And my way of living was really important. My medical benefits, my salary, stuff, the way that I lived every day, that my kids and family lived every day. That was my crutch. Couldn't afford to lose those things. Maybe I could, right? But we were at least the company where financially it was stable for me to continue that way of life and not injure that organization, which is super important. And it proved to be the foundation that really, really drove us to that next phase. In year one, with a one fully focused resource, really. I think, so I was here local. Daniel was working for a train rival in Canada somewhere, and Tony was in Afghanistan somewhere doing defense contractor stuff. Went full time, and it was the right change. We met all expectations and exceeded growth by 10x in first year. By beginning of 2012, Tony and Daniel, the other founders of the company, had went full time as well. That decision had propelled us into a place where we can stabilize resources in the company and turn it into actually something real, no longer a hobby. We didn't handcuff ourselves to stuff. We saw an opportunity and built a plan. We made some calculated decisions and executed the SRPs. We had no idea how the hell it was going to happen, but it did, and we accepted that change and moved forward. Did we get it all, you know, right off the jump? There's no, absolutely not. Did we get it all right today? Hell no. But we make educated decisions. I think something that stuck with me that Matt Mullenweg said years ago, and I'm paraphrasing because I don't remember the exact quote, but he was something along the lines of the least early to iterate off of. Or finish the statement. You know, it's so simple and yet so powerful. And relate that to anything you do today. That isn't about pushing code to core. Right? It's in everything we do. Release early, iterate off. Change is hard, and it's really scary. And these are all things we've chatted about now. One of the worst attributes, I think, of change is that you end up settling for whatever happens, right? That iterate often, but it's still important in that statement, right? We shouldn't do that. That's super scary. It can be really scary. Every time you get the feeling of not having control of what happens to you, you make the change and you kind of stay complacent, you settle for what happens there. Is that the end game? Are we really looking forward to that vision, that measurable commitment? Be confident and take action against that fear. You need to continue to iterate. I think I've battled long enough. This really brings me back to today. Why am I here? I don't think it has anything to do with hats or tacos, that's for sure. It may be something to do with my military and WordPress connection, but even both of those are byproducts of my willingness to accept change.
this out by Googling, but has your guys' board changed at all since you guys started?
The what now?
Has your like board of advisors or your team that decides, that, are you guys still a pretty tight group, or is it different?
That's a really good question. There has been change there. We were an organization of about 130 employees worldwide, 26 countries as a time of acquisition last year. I had come back on board. I had left for a small stint in the agency space and came back on board. It's the special projects guy. Along with Tony and Daniel, the rest of the organization through the transition to GoDaddy last year. There was a third-party organization that had best interest in security that went with that transition, and we're now fully owned company, and proud to say, of GoDaddy, and that structure has changed a bit. So we're part of the overall security business unit out at GoDaddy, and with that, we now manage not just the security brand, which has the WAF and all those things. We also take care of the SSL business and backups as well.
Do you have time for follow-up?
Follow-up question?
Yes.
You grow and we'll ask a question.
Did it happen to you, but in my opinion, what was the over-sexualized nature of GoDaddy's marketing strategy early on? Did it have anything to do with the over-sexualized nature of GoDaddy's marketing strategy early on in the Super Bowl phase?
You know what's cool is that this discussion is about change and transition.
Yeah.
And what that organization has done under some really strong leadership has taken the opportunity to write that. And 5 years, 6 years ago, that company is not what stands today.
I feel very strongly the same way. That's why I'm going to ask that question.
Yeah, they've done a really good job. I'm proud to be part of GoDaddy family, for sure. Really, really awesome company.
Exactly.